So this is okay. It's about the statistical data. We already talked about that before. We have variable data and attribute data. We already talked about it in unit one, I think. Variable data are continuous data, okay? Continuous measurements like length, weight, concentration, that they can have really, really different values. They can have fluctuation like this. They can change from one number to another one. Attribute data are data that are discrete data. So variable data are continuous data, continuous measurement. Attribute data are discrete data, like counts. As I said, let's say the age of a student in CI course, okay? So the age of a student can be 20, 21, 22, 23, right? So our students in CI class, they are from 20 to, let's say, 28, okay, 20, 21, 22. But the weight can be, let's say, we can have one student that has 50 kilogram and 50.5 kilogram. The another student can be 61.3 kilogram. So the weight is continuous, but the age is kind of count, is a district data, okay? Yeah, maybe you can say, okay, my age is 21 years and 6 months and 5 days. Let's say, you know, let's not to make it complicated, just talk about the age, because if someone you know, asks my age, I usually say, you know, the, like, some round number, right? It's just one example. Count means that, attribute data are like counts, are counts, like age and some other parameters. Then, okay, now, control chart. I'm just gonna give me some water, give me 1 second, please. Okay, control charts are, as I said, the graphical representation of a certain parameter, descriptive parameter. So, let's say you are producing chemical. You can measure the pH. You can measure the concentration. You can measure, I don't know, the amount of sodium in that chemical. You can measure the amount of oxygen in that chemical. You can measure different parameters. Then you can plot each of that parameter versus time. You have your production line. You have a sampling point. So your products are coming from production line. Okay. So the products are coming here. You have a sampling point here that you take sample of your product each second, each three products, each four products, something like that. There is a procedure to do that. Then you measure, let's say, the pH of your product, okay, each time, and then you can plot it in a figure like that we call it control chart. So you can you can take average of each three measurements and plot the average here. So this point can be your average. You can take each three samples, four samples, and measure the standard deviation and plot the standard deviation. So we can have different type of control chart. It's a graphical representative of certain descriptive statistics. So it can be the parameter itself. It can be the average. The parameter itself, it can be the average, it can be a standard deviation, variance, some other parameters. So this y-axis can be any of these parameters. For a specific quantitative measurement. A specific quantitative measurement means it can be either pH, it can be concentration, it can be amount of oxygen, nitrogen, whatever product it is. So it helps to record data and let you to see when an unusual event is happening in the process. Okay, so you can check to see your process is out of control, in control, okay, you can detect any unusual events. It can help to detect between in control and out of control process. Then it will also tell the to operator that when the process is in control or out of control. Okay, so in that case the operator can make, if it's let's say out of control, the operator can make necessary adjustment or necessary action to bring the process back to the control. Okay, so we even talked about this date, this assumptions before in control chart. We always, when we want to plot the control chart, we always assume that the data, there is a variation in my data. Okay, there is variation in my data. Data are normally distributed. Okay, data are normally distributed. My samples are independent. I will talk about independent or dependent sample. The last of this unit. I mean the last part of this this video. So we always consider that my samples are independent. Okay, so when there is, as another assumption is that when the process is out of control, my control chart shows a behavior that I can detect that my process is out of control. So as I said, the samples are tested at specific intervals. This specific interval can be minute, can be hour, can be second, can be millisecond, and then we will plot them. All control chart contain a center line, which is my target value, the value that I want to have, the mean of my data that I want to have, and also upper and lower control limit. And sometimes also we can include the specification limit, USL and LSL. But it has always upper and lower control limit, LCL and UCL. Okay, so let's look at this value. This is a typical control chart. This green line is my center line, is the average of my measurements here. This point, this blue point, is the average of this measure. Is of, if I take an average of all these points, I will reach to this green line. So the average of the parameters that I have for a in control process. If my process is in control and I take an average of all these parameters, I can have this green center line. So this, the value of this green center line here is the average of this blue point. That most of the time, this is also my target value, the value that I want to reach. Let's say if the measurement is for pH, I don't know, for a parameter concentration, this green line, which is the center line, is usually my target value, the value that I want to reach in the process, the desired value that I want to reach. Upper specification limit, as I said, is somewhere here usually. Upper specification limit. Upper specification limit is inside the control limit, don't forget that. So these two lines that I plotted, those are my lower specification limit, lower. Lower specification limit and upper specification limit, okay? So, upper specification limit is the largest allowable value for the quality characteristic that the customer requires. So this is the upper, if it's a pH, this is the upper limit that the customer wants for the pH. If the pH is more than that, he or she or the company, the government, whatever is your customer, they won't accept. Lower control limit is the lowest amount of that quality, that parameter that the customer will accept. Then we have upper control limit and lower control limit. That, as I already explained, okay, if my data is within these two limits, okay, the process is in control. And if my data is out of this range, these two range here, my process is out of control. So for an in control process, all my sample points has to be within these two range. Tolerance is the acceptable range of measurement on a specific. Okay, so like tolerance is like we have is another parameter, let's say is another parameter that we have, it has a definition, usually statistical definition, is that how much the variation is acceptable. I mean, how big the magnitude of the variation can be. Okay, so this tolerance has also, there are some equations that we can calculate tolerance, but for now is not important for the scope of this unit, so I'm not gonna explain it more. Stability is also stability in measurement. So if the analyzer each time gives me a really really different measurement value, so that means my analyzer is not stable, and most of the time is because of the calibration issue that the analyzer doesn't give us a right value. And if we don't have a good analyzer, if we don't have a calibrated analyzer, we don't have a stability, and we will have an unstable process or measure. Okay, so from control charts we can observe common cause variation or a special cause or assignable cause. When we see a common cause, no need to worry a lot. Okay, don't tamper, no need to interfere really. Just try to reduce the overall variation. Okay, don't rush in interference with the process. Just try to detect the source and try to reduce it, because when there is common cause, the process is working in the stable way, is in control, no need to do major change. But for us, if you have assignable, that we also call it a special cause, so you have to really identify it, you have to tamper, you have to identify the problem, you have to fix it, you have to prevent it. So in most of the case, you might need to solve the process and do major change, or is if it's really due to the problem of operator or workers, you have to take some decision related to that. Okay, so a controller chart again is the controller chart again, it includes those are the major component of each control chart. We have a trend chart. This is my trend chart, the plotted line. Those are my trend chart. You have center line, as I said, which is usually is the average of these blue lines or your target value. And you have control limit, upper control limit, lower control limit. Those are the major components of control chart. Okay, how we can plot the control chart, I will show you. So if let's say you measure your data and you have such a distribution, is a nice normal distribution that you have. Okay, it's a nice normal distribution. So most of your data are in a certain range. Okay, so this is your lower control limit and this is your upper control limit. All your data for a stable process has to be within this lower control limit and upper control. And as you can see, lower and upper control limit that are really far from the mean, it means we have a good tolerance most of the time in the process, that we can tolerate a very big variation. As you can see, most of the time the data are located far from these two center lines. Okay, most of the data are here in this center. So the control limits are really set far from the mean, which is somewhere here, to make sure that we don't need to stop the process each time if there is a small variation. Okay, so as long as the data are within this limit, is okay, we can accept it. Okay, if we just rotate the chart, okay, turn the chart, we can show it in this way. So if you have a distribution, if you rotate it, you can convert it to the control chart, that the center line will be the middle, the mean here. This is your upper control limit and this is your lower control limit. So this figure, these two slides shows how distribution and control chart are related to each other. Actually they are the same, okay, but just is the way that we are showing them is different. Okay, now how to find UCL and LCL. This is a very good question because we have different methods to find it. The first method, UCL and LCL. So in this course, in this unit, most of the time what you are asked to find UCL and LCL. So we have different method to do it. We have really different way to do it. We can use different equations. One of the simple and most useful equation or rule is 3 sigma rule. Okay, 3 sigma tells us that most of the time the LCL and UCL is within 3 standard deviation of my mean. Okay, so if I have a process, I have sampling measurement, I have the mean of X bar and the standard deviation of the mean, which is the standard deviation of my samples divided by number of samples, the standard deviation of the samples divided by number of samples. So most of, then it will tell us if we have a mean and a standard deviation of the mean is X bar, LCL and UCL is three, between the three sigma of my mean. Okay, so what you need to do, you need to measure the mean, you need to measure the sigma, and at the end you will have just LCL is X minus 3 sigma, UCL is X plus 3 sigma. There is another parameter that they call it also LWL. UWL is lower and upper warning limits. Okay, I'm not gonna talk about this because it's just some extra information that some process chart, they have also this limit, which is a little bit is close to a specification limit. Warning limit means that when your variation reach to these two value, you will receive a warning from your alarms, from I don't know your process control design, the design that you have. So when the variation hit one of these two limits, warning limit, you will receive some warning that your process is getting out of control. Be careful, do some quick action about it. So that's about this part. Now I think we have we have one example here. The concentration of a sample, as I said, I'm not gonna talk about UWL and LWL, you can calculate it yourself, but for now just let's focus on UCL and LCL. So we have measurements of concentration. We have 10 measurements for concentration. We have a production line that we take 10 samples and we measure the concentration, which is listed here. The mean is the mean, which is X bar. The mean which is x bar, okay, is this one, 3.9, and the standard deviation. So consider this the standard deviation of the mean, okay? The standard deviation is, oh, come on. A standard deviation, this is S x bar. So UCL and LCL calculated by using 3 sigma rule. So by 3 sigma rule, UCL is x bar plus 3 sigma. LCL is x bar minus 3 sigma. 3 standard deviation. So you have all, you have x and a standard deviation, just plug it in these equations and you can find UCL and LCL. As simple as that. Note that control chart generally they have more than 25 points, okay? So a control chart has usually most of the time generally more than 25 data points. Sometimes also for simplicity, especially in this course, we use only 10 points. But the real control chart, they have usually more than 25 data points.